You are about to enter the world of Steve Vertlieb, the man who saved the movies. Show on a children's TV show called Garfield Goose and Friends in Chicago, WGN, and they some company took a film that was made in Czechoslovakia. I think it was called Journey to the Center of Time, and it was not a god awful film. It had some good animation in it. These kids go back in time and they see dinosaurs and whatnot, and I think the film was actually made in the 1950s, and it was dubbed and shown in America in the 1960s. But the version we saw as kids, it was chopped up into a 5-minute serial every day. And all I could remember about that is that these kids were on a raft constantly, endlessly. And they saw all these cool-looking dinosaurs, but they never seemed to get off. But the thing was that kept us hooked was the announcer would say, "You won't want to miss the next exciting episode of Journey to the Beginning of Time." And I was a little boy. And so every day or every other day, I had to see this thing. So that technically is the first serial I ever saw. And the next one was Flash Gordon. And I liked Flash Gordon so much, I always hoped to meet the actor who played Flash Gordon, who was Buster Crabb. And Buster Crabb happened to be a very good friend of Steve's, too. Without my wanting to, I became a old movie film fanatic because when I was growing up, you saw everything. You saw Westerns, Gene Autry, Roy Rogers, who my dad couldn't stand. He didn't like singing cowboy Westerns. He thought they were a little, you know. So he liked John Wayne and Hopalong Cassidy and all that stuff. And back in those days, in the 60s on TV, they were still on the air. Everything. You got to see everything. That was the wonderful thing about TV back then. It wasn't Turner Classic Movies that you would have to go out of your way to see. It was just something that was there. So you'd see the Bowery Boys. You'd see Laurel and Hardy. You'd see Abbott and Costello. You'd see Sherlock Holmes. You would see something recent like The Dirty Dozen or The Great Race or something, and you got to see everything. And some of these old movies were so bizarre and weird, I wanted to find out who made them. how they were made, and that's kind of what got me started, my interest in old movie serials and King Kong and things like that. Late, I think, in 1992, my friend Bill Naris, who has since passed away, tragically, he was involved in an industrial accident. But Bill was one of those guys who, he was take charge, who was kind of, either you do it my way or, you know, take the highway. And if you put your ego in check and work with him on a worthwhile project, you had a lot of fun. And one of the things he wanted to do a 60th anniversary tribute to King Kong. And he wanted to get a hold of anybody who was still around, who was in good shape, that had worked on Kong. And we were going to, everything was set for a gentleman by the name of Linwood Dunn, who was in his 90s at the time. He was still in pretty good shape. He had worked on some of the special effects, not necessarily the animation, but he worked on the optical wipes and different things, and he was a well-known and well-respected person in Hollywood. Unfortunately, he called us up, I think, 4 or 5 months after we had everything printed up and everything ready to go. We had a theater booked. We got a print from Ted Turner's people. It was a 35-millimeter print that they had restored, and all the cut scenes from King Kong were reinstated the way they should be, and they used a computer technology to take all the scratches and dirt out, and they cleaned up the soundtrack. It was the best-looking print that people like Steve and George Turner had seen ever. And we were proud to get that. We had to pay Paramount and Ted Turner 35% of the gate, so we didn't make very much. But Linwood Dunn had to cancel. He had to do a special effects. It was either a dinner or a presentation. It had something to do with the Oscars. They do some of their other stuff on a different day. And he had to cancel at the last minute. So we thought, oh boy, what are we going to do now? So our next choice, we tried to get Ray Harryhausen and Ray Bradbury, who were two super King Kong fans. Unfortunately, both were so good friends, they said, you know, if you can get Ray Harryhausen, I'm coming. And Ray Harryhausen said, if you can get Ray Bradbury, you know, I'll come too. Ray Harryhausen was living in London at the time. I think he had a house in Los Angeles and London. And we weren't able to get him because he was tied up, and he regretted it. Ray Bradbury got to be very good friends with my friend Bill, and I'm very jealous about that because I never got a chance to talk to him, and I'm jealous of Steve because Steve became a very good friend of his. But at any rate, we couldn't get the two Rays, so we had to take second best. We had to take Steve Vertlieb and another writer and film historian by the name of George Turner. And the reason we wanted Steve was because Steve had befriended General Marion C. Cooper, who was the co-producer and director of King Kong. And Steve knew General Cooper pretty well. They corresponded. I think they were on the phone quite a bit in his later years. And George Turner had co-written the book, The Making of King Kong, with one of the King Kong animators, Orville Goldner. So those were two pretty big people who had met and befriended most of the people that worked on King Kong. I mean, here's a man who not only got to meet some of these great people, but he got to be very good friends with them. And there's a big difference between walking up to a movie star and saying, hey, could I have your autograph? And then he could say, hey, I met so-and-so, blah, blah, blah. But Steve actually became very good friends with people like Ray Harryhausen and Ray Bradbury, who would go out of their way if they were in the area, to meet up with Steve. That's a big difference. Steve is a professional writer himself, and he knows quite a bit about the business, and I think they respected that. spider pit sequence was so terrifying that it kind of, I think General Cooper, Marion Cooper, said that it stopped the show. It was just too much for the audience, and the film ran much smoother without that sequence in there, because here come the spiders and they're gobbling up all the sailors, and it was just too much. Of course, we being film purists and historians and everything, we want to see that sequence put back in, and actually Peter Jackson, it's one of the things I do like, he tried to reconstruct that scene. And it's kind of fun to see it that way.
Kill it!
But I think the reason that the original King Kong and the Ray Harryhausen films and so many other things are timeless is because they represent, you know, a kid's wish to be in a fantastic world and maybe to fight dragons and monsters and that kind of thing. And I think some kind of version of that will always be with us. I mean, the Star Wars movies came from the old movie serials, basically, especially Raiders of the Lost Ark series. So people like Steven Spielberg and George Lucas are very much like Steve Vertlieb, because Steve Vertlieb had a love for the things he saw in his childhood, and he recognized them as something good and timeless. He befriended a lot of these people that made these films or wrote these stories, like Ray Bradbury, and did special effects like Ray Harryhausen. And he... He got them, and we're talking about the early 1960s or late 1960s now. There hadn't been that big rush of fandom, really. So these people were impressed that here's this little kid who knows so much about the stuff they did. They started to get to think, hey, maybe my stuff is good. And I think Steve should be congratulated for the fact that he was one of the first people who really let these people know. Does that sound right? He was one of the first kids who gave these creative people an idea that there was a huge audience out there who really respected their work. And I think he should be congratulated for that, and that's why I'm here.
Possible?
No. I can't.